Okay, so I guess we have no special music. All right, well, good afternoon, everybody. It's good to be here, great to be here. I have really enjoyed and been just blessed by the last 3 days. I kind of hate to leave, but I'm kind of happy to leave because I'm going back to my wife and my two little munchkins, as I call them, my two-year-old and my five-year-old, and they can't wait for Daddy to come home. I've got a number of things I want to mention before I get into this talk. The one I gave this morning, the Lord really blessed that, and a number of people came up to me afterwards and said, where is the information from that talk? First of all, I believe, pretty sure that this is being recorded, and so I'm assuming that these talks will be available in the future for those that want to get the information. There is a book that I've written, one book, which is called The Character of God Controversy, and I believe there's still some copies in the Weimar bookstore. And that book has one chapter called The Message of the Righteousness of Jesus Christ. And the scriptures and the information that I gave is in that chapter. But like I said, I think most of it should be on the video or the audio that you can watch. And the main thing is to read the book of Romans and to read the Bible and read the book of Revelation and let the Holy Spirit guide you to put the pieces together, because that's what we all need to be doing. Let's see. Okay, my title. I've had a number of questions about this title. Detoxify or Die, The Hidden Role of Heavy Metals in Many Diseases. And some people have asked me, what kind of heavy metals are you going to be talking about? Are you talking about heavy metal rock and roll? And they couldn't quite figure that out. And so my answer is no, I'm not talking about rock and roll. I've talked about rock and roll a little bit when I gave my testimony on Wednesday morning that I used to be into rock and roll, but no more. Now I'm into Jesus and good music like we've heard at the Weimar camp meeting. That's the kind of music I like to listen to. Let me see, what else do I want to say? The title of this talk is based actually upon a book. I haven't given this talk a lot of times, and I've fished around for a title. It's a different subject than I normally speak on, and I read a book recently called Detoxify or Die by a doctor, very capable MD, who is an expert, as far as I can tell, in heavy metal toxicology. And so I just picked the title of the talk based upon the book, and I'll share a little bit more of this later. I've also come up with a little phrase that I don't know if I've coined it or not, but the phrase is that the one of the smartest things that an ignorant person can do is to connect himself or herself with those who know what they're talking about. And when it comes to this subject, that's what I have tried to do. I'm going to share with you a journey that my family has been through that is very personal to me. And I do it because I believe that it will be a blessing to you and that it will be valuable information. That's the reason why I share it, and I have sensed the Lord leading me to do this for many months. Now, I want to preface what I'm about to say, or at least my talk, by clarifying that I am a minister. I am not a doctor. I'm not an MD. And anybody that has any serious medical conditions definitely needs to be under the care of a qualified MD. That is for sure. I also want to just mention that this talk, like I said, is my story. It nor me has been officially sponsored by Weimar or by Amazing Facts. This is the story that's happened to my life, happened to my family. And like I said, I hope that it is a blessing to everyone. So I hope that you'll keep all this in mind and that we will have a very enlightening time together. How's that sound? All right, let's open our Bibles to the book of Mark, Mark chapter 5. I want to base this on a Bible passage. It's a very personal story. Before I had a son and a daughter, I used to tell lots of stories in my sermons. And a lot of them were about my dog. We used to have a dog named Jax, and he had an unfortunate demise, and I actually wrote a book about his death and about the struggles my family went through over Jax. I actually wrote a book called Will My Pet Go to Heaven? That Amazing Facts liked so much that they decided to take over the rights and publish it. So if you're interested in that book, you can get that from the Amazing Facts catalog. And anyway, after Jax died, and then we got another dog named Rerun. And because I was into television, and Rerun looked just like Jax. And so we named him Rerun. And unfortunately, Rerun is no longer with us either. He was killed by a coyote in South Sacramento at my wife's parents' house. And anyway, somebody told me once when I was pastoring in Templeton, they said, as soon as your son is born, you're going to stop telling all your dog stories, and you're going to start telling stories about your child. And boy, was he ever right. That's exactly what happened. And so for the last 5 years, I've been weaving into my talks about my little boy, Seth, and then my little girl, Abby, who is now 2 years old. And I'm a very happy father, as you can imagine. I think you can sense that as I've shared so far. And what I'm going to share with you right now is just so personal and so deeply interwoven with my heart and my wife and my family and my life that I just, you know, it's gonna move me, and maybe it'll move you as I get into this. And like I said, I hope that it will be a blessing to everyone. So let's bow our heads and let's pray a prayer again and just ask God to be with us and to talk to our hearts as we get into this subject. Dear Father in heaven, Father God, again, I thank you for being so good to me and to everyone here. Your grace is overabundant, and your love is beyond words. And we pray for your blessing. This is my last talk here before I go home. Please be with me as you've been with me so far in all these talks that I've given. Be with everyone here and those that are watching on Weimar TV. Please encourage us and enlighten us and speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. Mark chapter 5. This is where I want to lead your mind to. Mark chapter 5, verses 25 to 34, takes us back 2,000 years ago to the time of Jesus, to one major scene in the life of Christ. Jesus had been traveling around, as he often did during his public ministry. He was healing the sick. He was casting out devils and teaching the truth of his Father, the truth of God's word. And in verse 25, we have the beginning of a very interesting experience. It says that a certain woman had an issue of blood for 12 years. Now, I don't really know exactly the nature of what kind of disease fully this was, this issue of blood. You know, it was a female issue probably. What exactly it was, I'm not sure. The Bible doesn't really go into a lot of details. And it doesn't even mention her name. It just says a certain woman. But I do know that Jesus knew her name, and that Jesus knows your name, and he knows my name. And whatever physical problems we are going through, Jesus knows all about them. And that's very encouraging to me. He knows all the hairs on our heads. He knows everything about us, every ache, every pain, every problem, every struggle. Jesus knows all about it. And he longs to help us. And one of these days, by the grace of God, when we're in the resurrection, we'll all have new bodies. And then there'll be no aches and pains forever. Isn't that going to be great? It's going to be fabulous. Well, anyway, this lady had some kind of a disease, and she suffered with this disease for a long time. Not just for a year, or 2 years, or 5 years, or 10 years, but how long did the Bible say? Yeah, 12 years. Now, that's a long time to suffer with a serious disease. Wouldn't you agree? And when a person has any major physical problem, I mean, it can make your life a tremendous burden. It can just take all the joy and all the happiness out of everything you're doing. And in verse 26, there's another interesting verse here, and I've got a clarification to make when I read it. But in verse 26, the Bible says that this woman also suffered many things of many physicians, and she spent all that she had on these physicians, and she was nothing bettered, but she rather only grew worse. Now, I want to clarify that I certainly am not against physicians or medical doctors. When I was 5 years old, I mentioned a couple days ago that I had a pain in my side when I was fishing with my dad, and I was rushed to the hospital, and they found out through an examination that I had ruptured my appendix. My life was at stake, And I'm very thankful for qualified physicians who operated on me and took out my appendix and saved my life. And of course, you know, here at Weimar Institute, there are many very capable and qualified physicians that are here that are helping people tremendously with their health problems. So I'm certainly not against doctors as a whole. But it is also true that there are some times, and I think everybody knows this, it's pretty obvious, that there are some times that when a certain doctor may look at you or may analyze what's going on in your life with your health problem, that they just may not, you know, be able to help you. Or they may not really understand the nature of really what's going on inside your body. And in this particular case with this woman, it's pretty clear that was the situation with her. She had all kinds of physicians that she went to. She gave them a lot of money, and as a result of her spending her money and going to them time and time again, they didn't help her. She didn't get any better. She only got worse, worse and worse and worse. When you read the book Desire of Ages, the comments on this particular woman's situation are, it's just sad. And let me just read, if I can find my glasses here, a couple of sentences from Desire of Ages. The chapter is called The Touch of Faith, page 343. And it talks about how Jesus was on the way to the ruler's house, and he met in the crowd a poor woman who for 12 years had suffered from a disease that made her life a burden. She had spent all her means upon physicians and remedies only to be pronounced, and the word is incurable. They basically said, look, we don't know what your problem is. We can't help you. You've tried. You've given us your money. We're sorry. You're not getting any better. And the bottom line is you have an incurable disease. Now, that's not very encouraging for someone to hear, is it? You know, if you're struggling with a health problem and you're told that there's just no hope for you, sorry, there's nothing more that we can do. Something similar, although not entirely, I mean, it wasn't quite as severe, but something similar happened with me and my wife and my little boy a number of years ago, and it's continued on, and I'm going to explain this to you in the hopes that I'm sharing some valuable information, because it has really changed my family. It's been just a tremendous enlightening experience when it's all over. It started in 2007, a few years ago. My little boy was 3 at that time. Our daughter, Abigail, had not yet been born. And I had been invited to speak at the Northern California Camp Meeting, which isn't too far from here. I don't know how many of you have been to Northern California Camp Meeting. Any hands up here up in the Redwoods? Beautiful place. And in the summer of 2007, I was the main evening speaker. And I spoke 10 nights in a row in front of a large crowd on a lot of different subjects. And my little boy and my wife were there every night. The last day before we left, we got up in the morning, we had prayer, we had a little Bible study worship, I have a little kid's book that I would read to Seth, and the particular story was about the book of Job. And it showed some pictures of Job having these boils and Satan talking to God and things like that, and how eventually, you know, Job had all these problems. But finally, at the very end, God made it all right. If you know the story of the book of Job. And we read this, and then I remember saying this to my little boy, only 3. I said, Seth, the lesson here of this story is that sometimes things that are bad can happen even to God's people. And that if they do, we still need to trust the Lord no matter what. And that Jesus is going to take care of us, and it's all going to work out at the end. Something like that. So then we got into the car, and we started back toward Auberry, California, which was where we lived at that time. And we're driving down the peaceful highway, I believe it was Highway 101, through the Redwoods. We're winding our way down, heading toward Sacramento, heading toward Fresno, and then up into the mountains to Auberry, where we lived. And after driving for an hour or so, I remember driving at the wheel, my wife was sitting next to me, and I looked in the rearview mirror, and behind me was my little boy, and I saw him as I often saw him, just you know, slowly fading out as the motor of the car was putting him to sleep. And I remember looking at him in the rearview mirror and seeing him just fade out. And I had this peaceful feeling, you know, my little boy is taking a nice nap. He needs a nap. Well, about 2 minutes later, Kristen turned around and looked back at Seth, and then she looked at me, and she I don't know if she shouted, but she said very anxiously, she said, "Steve, something is happening to Seth." And I turned around and glanced while I'm driving down the highway, and I saw him with his head sort of cocked like this, and his hands were over at his side, and his eyes were about half open, and he was just rhythmically jerking like this. Like that. And I just, you know, panicked and pulled over as fast as I could and went and got out of the car and ran around the side, and I tried to shake him, and I said, Seth, are you having a bad dream? What's going on? Are you okay? Are you having a bad dream? And he wasn't having a bad dream. He was having, as many of you, I heard the word, he was having a seizure, his first seizure, at least the first seizure that we had observed. And I had never seen anything like this, especially with someone that's in my immediate family. And I started praying, and I panicked, and thankfully there was a convenience store right down the street. We pulled in, I ran in, I told the lady, my son's having a seizure, I've got to call the doctor. So I got on the phone, I called 911. And thankfully, there was a hospital right around the corner. And an ambulance quickly arrived on the scene, very quickly, and within 2 minutes or so, he was out of it. And he was crying, he kind of knew something was going on, his body wasn't working right, and the ambulance picked us all up and drove us just about 5 minutes away to a hospital. And as we got to the hospital, they ran a whole bunch of tests on his blood, all kinds of things. And after sitting there for about 3 hours or 4 hours, I still remember the doctor coming to me and giving me the final verdict of all the results that they had done. And he looked at me and he said, "I can't see anything wrong with your boy." And he said, have you ever heard of night terrors? He's probably had a night terror, where sometimes little kids, when they're sleeping, they just have these strange things, and they do that. So that's probably what it is. I wouldn't worry about it. Now, I'm certainly not blaming this man. I'm sure he's done a whole lot of good for a lot of people. But as you continue to listen to my story, it's very obvious to me that that was not really what was going on with my son. It was not a night terror at all. Well, anyway, we thought, well, shoo, okay, maybe it's a night terror. So we went on for another year, and nothing happened. Everything was fine. And then a year later, I had been invited to speak at a camp meeting in Norway. And I think there was somebody here, I don't know if you're in the audience right now, that was at that Norway camp meeting. She came all the way here. She was here a couple days ago at least. And anyway, this time we're all going. Kristen and Seth and me, again, we're all flying to Norway. I was going to speak there, and then we're going to take a little bit of vacation. You know, we try to mix ministry with a little vacation if I'm invited to a nice place. And so we're all on our way from West Coast to East Coast in the summer of 2008, and we had travel problems, plane problems, then we got stuck in Washington, D.C., and we missed our flight because of just mechanical woes. And so the airlines put us up in a hotel. We got into the hotel about 12 or 1 o'clock in the morning. We had booked a flight out the next day. We all went to sleep in the hotel. And at about 6:30 or 7 in the morning, I'm getting up, Kristen's getting up, and all of a sudden we look on the bed and we see Seth again. Eyes are kind of half open, and he's just convulsing. And this was a year later. And again, we panicked. We didn't know what to do. This was very new for us. And so I told someone at the hotel. They immediately called the paramedics. The ambulance came, ran tests, picked him up, rushed to the hospital. We all went to the hospital. They ran all kinds of tests. And after a couple minutes, he was out of it again, and he was fine. And they really didn't know what exactly was going on with him. Couldn't tell. Well, by that time, when I got back from Norway, they actually didn't continue on that trip. They went back home to Grandma's house, and I continued on to Norway. And when I came back, I found a neurologist in Fresno, not far from where we lived, who was at a specific center that professionally diagnoses people that have seizure conditions. And he ran a series of tests. We had an MRI done. We had an EEG done. Seth's brain waves started being monitored. They put the electrodes on him, and they started looking at his brain waves. And they found out that his brain patterns were very, what the neurologist said, they were very busy. They were busy. He called it a spike. As you go along the brain waves, you see it on the monitor, there's a spike and a spike and a spike. And the spikes are happening pretty quickly. And so the neurologist gave him, in Fresno, gave him a diagnosis. He said, the diagnosis that I'm giving your son is called benign Rolandic epilepsy. You can look it up on the internet. You can look it up in the medical literature. It's a condition that I don't know what percentage of children have it, but it's definitely out there. And that was the diagnosis that he gave my son, benign Rolandic epilepsy. And he said, if he has a third seizure, we need to put him on medication. And I thought, okay, well, I hope he doesn't have a third seizure. Well, 3 weeks later, we were on our way to the ASI convention. Speaking, I forgot the city that we were in, and we're on our way there, we're in a hotel, and another morning arrives, and I'm in a different room at that time of the morning, and I hear commotion coming out of the room. Kristen is yelling. I run in, and there is Seth again, lying on the bed, convulsing again, having another seizure. And this time, when he woke up, he was aware of what had been happening. His legs weren't really responding. He tried to get up, and he couldn't get up. And because the previous two seizures, he didn't remember really what was going on. But this one, he knew his legs were not cooperating. And he was quite frightened, and all of us were. And when the ASI convention was over, we went back to Fresno and spoke to the neurologist, and he again concurred at the same definition, benign Rolandic epilepsy, you need to put him on medication. And the medication that was recommended was called Trileptal, which many of you may be familiar with. It's a very well-known anti-seizure medication. I was very hesitant to give this to him because I just thought, you know, what is this going to do to his brain? I don't know. Like I said, I'm not a doctor. So I began to talk to different individuals that I wanted to go to someone that knew what they were talking about, and I'm not going to mention names, but I found out the names of a number of neurologists, very well-to-do, respected neurologists, pediatric neurologists, and I asked them their opinion. What do you think? Look at my son's condition. Here's the EEG. He has spike waves. He's very busy. He's had so many seizures. The recommendation is Trileptal. What do you suggest? Is it safe to put him on this? And every single one of them that I talked to on a professional level, they all said that they felt that Trileptal probably wouldn't hurt him. It probably won't have any bad side effects for his life as he gets bigger. And based on his condition, he will probably grow out of it when he gets to be a teenager. That's generally what happens with benign Rolandic epilepsy. And they said the rule of thumb is that he should be on the medication for at least 2 years, and then if he has a normal EEG at the end of 2 years, you can take him off, and if he doesn't, he should be on it until the condition goes away when he's a teenager. And that was the consensus of opinion that I got. And so I said, well, okay, if that's what is being recommended to me, then that's what I'll do. And so for the next 16 months, I ordered bottles of Trileptal, and every morning and every evening, my little boy would come to me, and he'd open his mouth, and I would place this medication in his mouth. And I just, you know, hoped and prayed that he was going to be okay, and that this was the right thing to do. Well, anyway, as time went on, for the next year or so, from the time of, that was August of 08, when he first went on Trileptal, for the next year, things went reasonably well. And when I say reasonably well, he didn't have any seizures, but there were two rather unusual things that were happening with him that I noticed. One of which was that his breath in the morning smelled awful. I mean, it was just like, it was just bad. And I couldn't understand that. And I thought, why is a four-year-old, you know, upcoming five-year-old, why is he waking up in the morning with awful-smelling breath? Something just doesn't sound right about, feel right about this. And the second thing that started happening, which was very strange, and it didn't happen every night, but it happened many different nights throughout the course of that year, and it was almost always about an hour after he went to sleep. I could almost look at it right on the clock. After he went to sleep, an hour later, he would wake up and he would do very strange things. Sometimes he would just sort of mutter, and he wasn't awake, he was just sort of out of it, and then he would throw himself back down on the bed, and then he would go back to sleep. Other times, he would do more than muttering. Sometimes he'd be waving his arms around. And many times, and this was one of the most frightening things, he would put his hands over his ears, and he would go like this. He would go, ah, like that. And to, you know, talk about trauma for a father's heart when you see your little boy with his hands on his ears going like this, ah. And I looked at him and I thought, something is going on inside of his head. You know, what is going on? And I went back to our neurologist in Fresno and I explained the situation to him, and I actually took a video of it. And he just really wasn't that concerned about it. He thought, you know, this is probably just something like a night terror or what kids do. He didn't think it was connected to the medication or not. I'm, you know, actually not really sure it was or not. I'm not positive, but something was going on inside of his head. And this went on off and on for a year. Well, the crisis moment came for my family a year later. It was about 8 months ago, in October of 2009, when my mother had been staying with my family for about a week, and she was sleeping in Seth's room, and Seth and me and Kristen and Abby were all sleeping in the big bed. And then when my mom left, Kristen decided not to make the bed the night that she left, Seth's bed, so Seth didn't go back into his bed that night, which I think was very providential. And we all slept together in the big bed that night. It was September 29, 2009. And as Seth went to bed that night, then he had another seizure. All of his seizures have been while he's asleep, never when he's awake. So he had another seizure. And now he's been on medication for a year now, and he's still having it. Or he has another one. So I call the neurologist that we had been working with in Fresno, and I explained the situation, and he said, this is what you need to do. He said, you need to go test his blood levels and test the trileptal levels in his blood, because you haven't been increasing the dose. He's been getting bigger. He probably needs more medication because his body's bigger and the dosage is the same. So we did that, and the results came back that, yes, his blood levels were very low in the trileptal, and so the neurologist said, you need to bump it up and increase the dose. And I thought, okay. So we did that. We increased his dose, and then 4 or 5 days later, he had another seizure. And then I talked to the neurologist again, and the consensus of opinion was that we may need to increase the dose even more. And I was just loath to do that. Now, this is where it all came together. And let me get all my notes here so I make sure that I'm telling you everything that's right. Because all the details are very, very important. Let's see, number two, number three. Okay, yes. Let's look back at our Bibles. Go back to Mark chapter 5. Let's go back to the woman who was not getting any help. And things were getting worse. In verse 27, it says that she heard of Jesus. She heard of Jesus. And she came in the press of the crowd behind him, and she thought to herself, if I can just touch his garment. For she said, if I may just touch his clothes, I will be whole. And what happened was, and the date, and I've got it written down here, October 15. Last October 15, Seth had his second seizure, and he was about to have two more, but I didn't know it at the time. So on Wednesday night, October 15, he had a second seizure during that bout. And that was on a Wednesday. On Thursday morning, I woke up struggling with a terrible dilemma. And the dilemma was that on Friday, the next day, was it on the 17th, I was scheduled to fly to Oregon for a Bible prophecy seminar, which I often do. I travel around the country. I hold seminars once a month. That's my criteria. Once a month, I'll be gone, and then I'm back to my family because I don't want to be an absentee father. That's my commitment. God first, family second, ministry third. That's my philosophy. And so anyway, I had a real struggle because the next day I'm supposed to go to Oregon, and they had advertised, they were going to have a, you know, big meeting with me there. They're all expecting me. And how can I leave my wife with a little boy that's having seizures that are increasing. And I just thought, and so I prayed. I thought of Jesus and I prayed. And I prayed one of the most earnest prayers that I've ever prayed in my life. And you know, I want to tell you that if I was sincere, I was sincerely sincere. I mean, I was as sincerely sincere as sincere can be. And I got on my knees that night, Thursday night, and I prayed to God with my whole soul. And I said, I prayed a number of things. One of the things that I prayed was, I said, Lord, if Seth has another seizure tonight, I'm not going. I cannot go if he has two seizures in a row and leave my wife. I just can't do it. And then my next prayer was, I said, Jesus, you have got to show me the cause of this condition. I'm just not satisfied with the diagnosis that there is no known cause to this condition and no cure. I'm just not satisfied. And I remembered, you know, these memories of the writings of Ellen White where she talks about disease has a cause. And we need to find the cause so we can bring about a solution. You know, let's get down to the root of the problem and try to correct the problem so we can solve the symptoms. You know what I mean? And so I'm praying. I'm saying, Lord, you've got to show me the cause. There's got to be a cause to this. I don't want him to be on medication for the next 10 years. I mean, if that's the way it has to be, if that's what you want, I'll do that. But show me the cause. Show me the cause. Well, Friday morning, I woke up, and he did not have a seizure that night. Very providential. And I flew to Oregon, Bend, Oregon, for a weekend seminar. That Friday night, I stood in front of the crowd, told them I almost didn't get here. Please pray for my son. It's been a real struggle for my family, but I am here, and I'm here to talk to you about Jesus and the Bible. Well, the Lord did some very significant things that weekend. In that audience was a lady that was a nutritionist, and she recommended to me out of the blue. She came up to me, she approached me, and she said that I have a... Let me back up a little bit. Right during that time as he was having those seizures, I started looking on the internet and doing just searches. I just started searching around seizures, benign rolandic epilepsy, causes. What are the causes of seizures? And I began just searching, trying to find out what's going on. And I don't want to tell you all the websites I found, but I did find some that did indicate that certain chemicals in the brain can cause seizures. And so when I got to Oregon and I mentioned this to the crowd, please pray for my son, this nutritionist lady who was in the crowd came up to me afterwards and she said that she recommends a product that she would wonder if I would consider giving to my boy. And it was called, and I'll tell you the name of it, you can research it, it's a kind of a technical name, PCA/RX. PCARX. It's developed by a company called Maxim Labs, and it seemed to be very credible, and it's a spray that you spray in the mouth, and the purpose of the spray, it's about $100 a bottle, it's not cheap, and the purpose of the spray is to remove heavy metals from the body. And I wasn't sure about whether I should give this to my son, so I actually did order it, and I got it. I got the little bottle, and I decided to call Dr. Agatha Thrash. How many of you know Dr. Agatha Thrash? She's a very good friend of mine, and she was also very aware of Seth's situation, and she was counseling with me as well. And I read these ingredients to Dr. Thrash, every single long name that was on this bottle. And she, in her brilliant mind, knew every single item or whatever it was, the solution. It was an all-natural solution. She said, I'm familiar with all of it. I've done research on seizures. And she said, go for it. Give it to your son. And so I thought, all right, based on Dr. Thrash's thumbs up, I'll do it. So I started giving this to Seth at the end of November, or was it October? It was at the end of October of 2009, started spraying it into his mouth. October 29th was the first spray. Psst, psst. Do a little bit in the morning, a little bit in the evening, and then you bump it up a little bit more. Well, 4 days later, after I was giving him this spray, the fourth night when I went to bed and Seth went to bed, I prayed and I had this wonderful sense of peace that Jesus was in charge of what was going on. wonderful sense of peace that he was listening to my prayers, loved me, understood everything that was going on. And that night, for the first time in a long time, my little boy slept like a baby. He slept like a log. And we have a little thing going on. I'll wake him. He'll wake up in the morning and I'll say, "Seth, did you sleep like a log, a leaf, or a pogo stick?" And he'll say, "Like a log, Daddy." And I tell you, that night, he slept like a baby. And he hadn't slept like that for a long, long time. During that month, October, when he was having these seizures and prior to that, and he would often sleep right in the bed next to us. And I'm laying right next to him at night, and I can feel his body up against mine. And off and on throughout the night, he'll all of a sudden just jerk. He'll jerk and he'll go, "Whoa." And sometimes he'll wake up and he'll do this thing and he'll throw himself down unconsciously and he'll be bouncing all over the bed. I mean, throughout the night, he's over here, he's over there, he's over here, he's over there. He's jerking all throughout the night. But that fourth night after giving him that spray, he slept just like a baby all night. And I had this wonderful peace, and I thought, wow, God is doing something. God is doing something. Well, that was November 1, a couple days after when we first started the spray. Well, November 4 was 2 weeks after I went to Oregon. I flew to another seminar. I did one in October, one in November, and I went to, this was early November, and I went to another, it was Seattle, Washington, not too far away from where I lived. One of my students from Weimar Academy, Calvin Kim, some of you know him, he and his brother Martin, Calvin invited me to speak in Seattle. And when I went to that seminar and I gave my talks, one of those nights I was sitting there talking to Calvin. And Calvin shared with me his testimony about all the struggles that he had with heavy metals in his body and how he almost lost his mind, almost lost his mind. And then he told me, he looked me right in the eye, and he said, finally, he said, I went and I found a doctor. He said, his name is Dr. John Mundall, Seventh-day Adventist doctor. And he said, Dr. Mundall helped me to get these chemicals out of my body. And then he looked at me and he said, Steve, he gave me my life back. Right in the eye, Steve, he gave me my life back. And I said, give me his name. So I wrote his name down, and he has a practice in Spokane, Washington, not too far from where I live. So when I got home, shortly thereafter, I got a hold of this doctor, and come to find out that he's a Seventh-day Adventist doctor from Loma Linda, an MD, and he is board certified in heavy metal toxicology. And I called him and said, I need to make an appointment with you. So we did make an appointment. We made the appointment on December 4. Now, December 4 was an interesting day, because December 4, we had been up living in the Idaho area now for a little over a year. And when we were living in Fresno, it was easy to get a hold of a neurologist. But up in the Washington, Idaho area, it's not so easy. Spokane is the hub in our area, and there's just a few pediatric neurologists that are there, and they're not easy to get an appointment with. So we spent almost a year when we first got up there trying to get an appointment with this doctor. And so that's the reason why in October, when Seth was having these seizures, I didn't call the Spokane neurologist because we hadn't seen him yet. I called my Fresno neurologist that I used to know, because he was the guy that gave me a cell phone and he was easy to get a hold of. And so now, but finally, we had an appointment, December 4, with one of the top pediatric neurologists in Spokane. And Dr. Mundall said, I'm available December 4 as well. So we made the morning appointment with the pediatric neurologist at the Sacred Hearts Children's Hospital in Spokane, and the afternoon appointment with Dr. John Mundall. And when we got to the hospital in the morning, we met with the doctor. He went through Seth's charts. We actually, I forgot to tell you, prior to that, had given him another EEG. We'd given him many EEGs in the last few years. And in October, when he was having these seizures, and I mentioned he had two, and then he had three, and he had four. He had four of them in October, one at the end of September, and three in October. And so we gave him an EEG, took him to the hospital. It was Holy Family, I think I've got that right, Children's Hospital in Spokane. And we gave him an EEG. They connected little electrodes to his head, and they looked at his chart, and A different neurologist read the report to me before we met with this doctor on December 4. And when he read it, he told me, he said, I concur, your son has benign relentic epilepsy. His brain activity is very busy. And then he told me on the phone, he said, he will probably have more seizures. And he may have more serious seizures because he's not far away from having grand mal. They may break out from during the night and have them during the day because his brain activity is very, very busy. That's what he told me. Not very encouraging, but that's what he told me. He gave me the report. And so anyway, on the morning of December 4, the final pediatric neurologist that we met in Spokane looked at Seth's EEG, confirmed the diagnosis, benign relentic epilepsy, and confirmed that there really is no known cause to this condition. And his opinion actually was a little bit different than some of the others. He said, you know, because of Seth's condition, he said, you really can keep him on the medication or not. It's up to you. If you want to take him off, that's okay. He's not going to die from these seizures. That's what he said. And he said, you know, he'll probably grow out of it. And if you want to take him off Trileptal, you can do it. And if you do, follow a schedule, and I'll give you a schedule, a weaning schedule to do it right, and so that when he's finally off, it'll be the right procedure to do it slowly. You don't just take somebody right off these medications. So I talked to him, thanked him, left with my wife and Seth and Abby, left his office and went down the street, made a right on Euclid, and went to Dr. Mundahl's office. Well, my experience with Dr. Mundahl was quite different. He also is a, you know, very skilled doctor, and he did something that nobody else had ever done. He did something. He said, what we need to do is we need to test your boy for the heavy metals and the chemicals that are inside of his body. And so he took a little bit of Seth's hair, and he had Seth go in the bathroom, and he peed a little bit into a little cup, and he said, we're going to test his hair and his urine, and I'm going to send his hair and his urine to a lab, and we're going to find out what's inside of his body. Well, about 2 weeks later, we got the results, and I've got them right here. Here's the results. And this came from Doctor's Data, which is, you know, a very professional medical lab that analyzes these kind of tests. And in this, you're not really be able to see this, but a number, he was on the high side of various heavy metals. He was definitely elevated in other areas. This is elevated. And as you look at this list, and then there's also another list of his. Well, I don't seem to have that here. But anyway, Seth's results were that he is very elevated in lead in his body. He's also very elevated in cadmium. He has high levels of barium, high levels of antimony. He has a goodly amount of arsenic. He has cesium and various other metals. And he also tested quite high in uranium. And when I talked to Dr. Mundahl about these results, he looked at me and he said, Steve, these heavy metals are neurotoxins. And when you combine them, they can definitely contribute or cause seizures in children. No question about it. That was his conclusion. And he said, what we need to do is we need to continue following the regime of you're using this spray to help get the metals out, and we need to do other things like a certain kind of chelation therapy and other things that we need to be doing to help detoxify your boy. That's what he said. And so I thought, that sounds good, let's do it. And as I continued to give Seth the spray and we started chelation therapy, and I also did more research on the importance of certain kinds of food that help detoxify or get rid of chemicals, such as garlic is a great detoxifier, and onions and cilantro, and some of the basic things that people use to help their bodies to get rid of chemicals, I started doing this, and I started giving him a little bit of aloe vera juice that had a little flavor to it so it tasted good and he could stomach it, and various things. I started researching, you know, what can I do to give him good minerals, vitamins, and get the chemicals out. That was my basic philosophy. Give him a good nutrition and try to get the chemicals out. And so we continued to do this, and then we stepped out in faith. we decided, all right, if the metals are the cause of his seizures, and if we, under Dr. Mundall's care, work on getting these metals out, then we're going to step out in faith and follow the pediatric neurologist's schedule and slowly, instead of increasing his medication, like the Fresno neurologist said, we're going to decrease it and we're going to slowly wean him off of it so that he's off of it entirely. And the target date for him to be off was January 27 of this year, 2010. And as we got closer to that date, we continued to buy the bottles of the spray, and Seth continued to improve in his sleeping patterns. Night after night after night, he started sleeping better. Night after night. And I noticed significant improvement. So January 27, we took him off the medication entirely. Well, the amazing thing was that January 28, 29, and 30, 3 days in a row, three nights in a row, 1 hour after he went to sleep, Seth woke up 1 hour later going like this, ah, like that. And I called Dr. Mundall and I said, Dr. Mundall, is this because we've taken him off the medication and he needs to be back on? Or is this because he's getting off of it and his body is recovering? And he was adamant that this is the body getting rid of this, getting rid of the chemicals, hold the line, stay the course. And then he mentioned, he said, tongue in cheek, he said, you know, there's something about the 3 days and three nights in the Bible. And just wait to end of 3 days and three nights and see what happens. Well, the fourth night, he didn't do it. The fifth night, he didn't do it. The sixth night, he didn't do it. Now, I think it was the seventh night, he had a seizure. It was not a big one, but it was a little one. And they had another one 5 days later, February 11. And I called Dr. Mundall and I said, you know, should we go back to the medication or just hold the course? And he said, hold the line. Hold the course. He said, this is still, you know, your son is, if there's going to be some bumps on the road, we're on the right track. Don't go back. And I said, all right. Well, my faith was rewarded. February 11, went into February 15, February 20, etc., into March, into April, no seizures. Not only that, but he'd wake up in the morning and his breath didn't smell. His breath didn't smell at all. And now here's the kicker. February 2nd, which was 5 days, you know, after he had gotten off the medication, we took him back to the hospital in Spokane and we gave him another EEG. And we waited breathlessly for the results of that EEG. When the EEG finally came back and we got the report from the same top neurologist in Fresno who communicated that to our pediatrician, who is a Seventh-day Adventist lady at our church in Newport, Washington, the result came back that Seth's EEG had changed. That it was no longer going like this night after night. And that that the diagnosis, the official diagnosis, had changed. That now he no longer has benign Rolandic epilepsy. And I told my wife, I told Kristen prior to that EEG, I said, honey, if as a result of what we're doing, these detoxification things, trying to get the metals out of his body, and he's sleeping better, and his breath doesn't smell, and now he's off medication, I said that if he has another EEG in February and it's a significant improvement from the one he had last October, I said, I'm going to go public with this story. I'm going to go public. And praise the Lord, that's what happened. And so now, as of this day, what's today? June what? June 11, right? Seth has been off all medication for over 4 months. He got off the medication in January. He had that last seizure February 11. In the last 4 months, he did have one more. He was sick and he was throwing up and he did have another one and it was very short and it was over. But January, February, March, April, May, June. It's been 5 months and now almost every night, he sleeps like a baby. He sleeps like a log, night after night after night. The EEG from October to February changed. His breath smells fine. He's happy every day, like he always is. And when I leave to fly on a trip like this, I'm not worrying that he's going to have a seizure, you know, at night when I'm gone. My wife sent me a text. I didn't bring my cell phone here because you're not supposed to bring your cell phones to these meetings, right? But my wife texted me this morning and said, we're all fine. Seth slept fine. Everything is fine. And so, you know, as I look at all this, I think to myself, wow, you know, now he's off medication. Now he's not having seizures. Now his breath smells fine. Now he sleeps like a baby. And about a week and a half ago, we all went back to Dr. Mandal and we all clip, 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 took a little bit of our hair, and he is sending it to doctor's data to the lab, and we're going to find out what the result is when we get the results back. Many people have asked me, where did Seth get those medals? And to be honest with you, I don't know. We've had our water filtered everywhere that we've lived, and I'm just not sure where he got them. But I can tell you that about a month and a half ago, I was doing research, just, you know, as a dad trying to figure this out. That's what I'm trying to do. So like I said, I'm not a doctor, but I'm telling you my story. And I found a website that recommended a book called Detoxify or Die by Dr. Sherry Rogers. I asked Dr. Mandal, I said, have you heard of Dr. Rogers? He said, oh yes. Not only does he know of her, but he knows of her mentor, William Ray, and these people are top of the line professional toxicologists in the United States who lecture around the world to doctors, to medical professionals. And in this book, Dr. Rogers, who is to me top of the line, she is loaded in this book. It's very easy to read, with clinical studies from Harvard, from Yale, from Columbia University, from the Mayo Clinic, from all kinds of places, and all kinds of scientific journals about the reality and the danger of chemicals, of toxins, etc., whether it's pesticides that are being poured on the plants, or whether it's pesticides that are being put in the soil, or whether it's chemicals that are in the water. And she'll convince anybody that we're the most toxic generation in the history of the world. And she says that they've done studies of women way out in the North Pole. They've looked at their breast milk, and they're loaded with chemicals. And she says that the EPA has done studies where they've looked at, you know, cadavers, and they've studied the fat cells of people that have died, and every single one of them in their fat cells has some kind of chemicals in there. And so anyway, I don't know where Seth got these chemicals. I'm not sure. I do know that the lab results show that he had them. I do know that we started a regime to try to get him off, to try to get them out of his body. I know that. I do know that when he was, prior to that, he had an EEG in October, and his brain patterns were very busy. And in February, when he had another EEG after our trying to get the metals out, I know that his EEG had changed. And I know that the diagnosis had changed from benign relentic epilepsy that doesn't have it anymore. I know that his sleeping patterns have changed. I know that now he's off medication, and he's not, you know, he's doing fine. And he sleeps like a baby night after night after night. I know all those things. And I'm not saying that every disease that anybody ever has is the result of chemicals. I'm not going to say that. But Dr. Rogers has convinced me that there's a lot of chemicals out there, and that chemicals were in my son, no doubt about that. And she basically says that there are two primary things that we need to understand. Number one is that the body is trying to get rid of the toxins that are in the environment, etc., and that we need to supply the body with as much nutrition as possible to help the body get rid of the chemicals that we're all exposed to. And I think that's just pretty basic. And like I said, I'm certainly not saying that everybody that has a disease you know, is the result of these things. But in our case, it's definitely been very real in my family. Now, let's go back to the Bible. I've got another 18 minutes left on the screen here. Back to the woman. In verse 27, she heard of Jesus, and she came in the press behind him, and she touched his garments. And she said, "If I can just touch his clothes, I will be whole." And when she reached out with the touch of faith, and I feel like I was like that woman. I was just praying, "Lord, you've got to help me. You are the great physician. You're the great physician. He's been diagnosed with a condition that apparently has no cure. But Lord, you're the great physician, and you can help him. You can help me. You can help him. You can help my family. Lord, please help me." And this woman reached out and touched him. And it says, straightway the fountain of her blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Now, I don't know what the physicians that she went to would have said if she would have come back and said, "I felt it in my body, I'm healed." I don't know what they would have said. Hopefully, they would have said, "Praise the Lord." The Bible doesn't tell us, but she knew she was healed. She knew it. And then it says, Jesus immediately, knowing in himself what had happened, that virtue had gone out of him, he turned about in the press and he said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "Lord, you see the multitude thronging you, and how can you say who touched me? Everybody's touching you. We're all touching you." But in the Desire of Ages, it says that her touch was the touch of faith. It was a different touch. It was an earnest touch, and that the faith of her whole life was in that touch. And then it says, he looked around about him to see who had done this thing. And the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. She told him the truth. And what I'm telling you this afternoon is the truth. It's what happened to me. It's what happened to my wife. It's what happened to my son. We've got the report, you know, right there. The doctor's data. We know that he's had this problem. We don't know where he got them, but we know, as Dr. Mundal says, these are neurotoxins and they can cause seizures. And now we know, like I said, his EEG has changed. He's off medication. He's sleeping like a baby, and his breath doesn't smell in the morning. And I tell you, I'm a happy dad. I'm a happy dad. I really am. And I want to glorify the great physician, because it's been a real struggle for me. I mean, I'm a minister. I have a calling from God to do what I'm doing. And he's blessed every talk that I've given, this camp meeting, hasn't he? Every talk that I've given, the Lord has blessed. And one of the hardest things that I've ever had to do is to continue my ministry when my child is suffering. And I told the Lord, "Lord, I'm not going to my next ministry appointment if my son has another seizure. You've got to solve this problem." And you know what? He did. He did. He worked in a mighty way to solve that problem. And like I said, I told my wife, I said, "Kristen, if Seth's EEG changes, I'm going to share this." And for the last 2 months, I've been sharing it. I wrote up a little article called "No Cause, No Cure?" And I sent it out to a group that's in my email database. And the response that I got was overwhelming. Every one of them positive. People really appreciated the fact that I told this story. I write a monthly column for Wisconsin Christian News. And this is another story, but it's a evangelical newspaper out of Wisconsin. And it goes across the country. And the editor of that, and this was being recorded, but that's fine because it's public knowledge, at least out there. The editor of that publication is not a Seventh-day Adventist, but he's very sympathetic with our positions. And he's a friend of mine, and he has allowed me to write a column there for 4 years. And he has a number of other Adventists, along with other evangelicals, that write different articles about different subjects. Well, this man has recently told me in the last couple months that he's gotten a lot of flack from readers of his that are not happy with the fact that he allows Seventh-day Adventists to put articles in his paper. And so he told me, he said, Steve, I'd like you to write a two-part series on Seventh-day Adventist doctrines and to clarify them before our readers to show that you really do believe in Jesus, you believe in the Bible, you believe in salvation by faith, and you believe in keeping the Ten Commandments as the fruit of your faith. And so I wrote the first part about a month ago and talked about various things, the Bible, salvation, faith, Jesus, the gospel, and about the Ten Commandments, including the Sabbath, and including what happens when you die, and about hell. And I wrote our position in a clear and simple way. And he told me, he said, you know, we got a big response from that. And he said, most of them were very positive responses. Few negatives, few warnings, but people are very anxious to get your next one. And the one after that, where I talk about the sanctuary, the investigative judgment, the mark of the beast, and Ellen White. So I'm writing these articles, so you pray for me. But anyway, I talked to him on the phone yesterday, and right before I've started this series called Seventh-day Adventism, Cult or Christian, where I mentioned Dr. Walter Martin as well, who came to Weimar Institute before he died, mentioned that. Rob told me, he said, you sent me your No Cause, No Cure article, which came out right before these other articles that I'm writing now. And he said the response was tremendous. People really appreciated in Wisconsin you're telling that story. A lot of health-conscious people, he said, in Wisconsin, and they were very happy and moved by what you wrote. So I know that the Lord is blessing this, and I'll tell you just another quick story. I've got 12 minutes left here. Wednesday, I was in the cafeteria, and you probably don't know this. I don't think you do, but there was a woman that came on campus. She's a doctor from Kaiser Permanente at the hospital in Sacramento. And she was on campus with one of her patients, and they were just checking out Weimar. And they're not members of our church, but they were here to look into the health program and very interested in what's going on here. And so she happened to get a hold of the camp meeting schedule, and she looked at it, and she saw my title, Detoxify or Die. And I'm sitting in the cafeteria last Wednesday, just eating, I think it was supper, and all of a sudden this woman, this doctor, comes up to me. She evidently, someone told her, that's Steve Wahlberg, and she came up, she introduced herself, and we had a conversation. And I shared with her a little bit of my story, and she said, I'm very interested in this. And she said, why don't you come? I'd like you to come down to Kaiser and give a talk to our doctors. And I said, you know, I'm not a doctor. I said, I'm a minister. All I could do would be tell my story. But I said, really what you should do if you want to get a professional who knows about, you know, the body and about health and about things like this, I said, you really should connect with Dr. Neil Nedley. And so she said, well, I'd like to do that. So she gave me her information. I talked to Dr. Nedley. I'm going to connect the two of them. And when I go back to Priest River, Idaho, and spend time with my family and my two little munchkins, hopefully the two of them will connect, and maybe this will be an open door for him to go down there and talk to the doctors. You never know what the Lord's going to do. You just never know. God can work in wonderful ways, all kinds of ways. And, you know, the bottom line is that this is my story to honor the great physician and to let people know what's happened to us, and that sometimes there are hidden causes to our conditions, and we need the Lord to help us to find out what those causes are, and sometimes, many times, probably, they can be corrected, and we can be healed of our difficulties. And that's what I've learned through this experience. Back to the Bible, the woman fearing and trembling. Sometimes I give this subject, fearing and trembling, because like I said, I'm not a doctor, I'm sharing my story. Fearing and trembling, she knew what was done in her. She came and she fell down before Jesus, and she told him all the truth. And Jesus said to her, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Your faith has made you whole. Go in peace and be whole of your plague. And I've read this, and it's just spoken to my heart. It's touched my heart. Anyway, I hope this is a blessing to you and that you'll do your own homework and your own study. I do think that Dr. Rogers' book is definitely worth reading. And anyway, I guess that's about all I've got to say. That's the main thing I have to say. And may God help you. May he help us. Thank the Lord that this minister, who's called to preach and teach the word, who's gone through a terrible struggle with the sufferings of my little boy, has felt the touch of God to help to solve our problem, so I can go out once a month and do these seminars and have a lot of peace and rest in my soul. It's just been a real blessing to me. So I hope it's been a blessing to you that I've shared this story. Let's do the best we can to take care of ourselves, to get all the good nutrition that we can get, and there's a lot of it at the Weimar cafeteria. That's for sure. And that's what this whole institute is all about. It's about teaching a healthy diet, a healthy lifestyle, so people can be helped and improve their physical bodies and their relationships with the Lord. And it's my privilege to have a chance to share this here in front of you. So let's bow our heads and let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, Father, thank you so much for giving me the chance to share this. Thank you for what you've done, Jesus, as the great physician, to help my little boy, to help Seth, to help my wife. And I just pray for every person here that you'll help everyone. Lord, you know every name. You know our names, and you know what we're going through. You know our struggles and our problems, and you can help us. You can help us. And if we don't get healed down here, we know that when you come again, Jesus, and we're resurrected, we'll have brand new bodies, and forever we'll have no pain, no suffering, no sorrow, and no death. Lord, may that day come soon, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, and thank you so much.